Well, so we've got a number of great pairings going on, and obviously going to be a very exciting day of chess today. And we've got some guest commentators in the room today. So, as well as being honoured by Stuart Rubin appearing, hi Stuart, great honour.
Thank you.
We have the main commentator. Sorry, Stuart, you can't take centre stage away from our friend, the Gibraltar monkey here. He actually has a Russian name,
He's
doesn't he? I
actually an
read
American monkey.
American monkey,
Yes.
okay,
He's
right.
a visitor.
Where'd you get monkeys in America?
In a store, Simon.
In a store, okay. And what's your friendly monkey's name?
His name is Vano.
Vano. Doesn't
Yeah.
sound very American.
It's not American.
Okay. And he's going to be probably doing some better talks on the positions than us at certain stages. And if we ever get worried and if we get tongue-tied, we're just going to do this and wave at you, which might well happen. But okay, some great encounters going on, and I think we'll shortly move into the games. And
Shortly, but before that, we are going to take a look at what we did this morning with a group of chess players. One of the things to do here in Gibraltar before the round is to visit the monkeys on the rock.
Okay.
So today we called it the Day of the Monkeys, and it's not actually an official Day of the Monkeys, but it's unofficially the Day of the Monkeys. And let's look at these pictures that we have here. The first one is with me and tournament director Stuart Conquest and his fox, which was a gift to him from another chess player. Then we have tournament arbiter Rainier from Germany. Rainier has this monkey on his shoulder, and he's actually really beloved by the monkey. He wasn't afraid of them at all, Simon. So they jumped on his back, on his head, and in fact, the monkey wouldn't even get off of him.
Happy monkey.
Yes. So then we got Stuart, fox, and monkey. Yes, that's a great one. Actually, the monkeys really wanted to steal Stuart's fox
Right.
away from him.
Very
So
confused,
that was
right?
one game that he played with them, with his fox. We have also Anastasia Savina, who joins us with her camera. Nice girl. And she speaks French, Simon. And
Okay.
I've heard her speak fluently, but I'm not sure how this Russian girl speaks such good French. So then there's another picture of me and the monkey. Yes, I love those monkeys. And finally, our technical producer, Leonard, also was very friendly with the monkeys. He always kept giving him his fingers, so they could
Yeah.
like hold hands, hold fingers.
Where are the monkeys now? Oh, hang on a minute. We're the monkeys at the moment, aren't we? So stuck with two
So it
monkeys
was
here.
still it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun to visit the monkeys. I do it every year that I come here. They were very friendly today.
And
They
is there
oh
any
and
more
we have
pictures
some oh
there?
yeah there we
Yeah.
have do have some more pictures. Yes, it's actually one of the most interesting parts came at the end when we were leaving in the car, and the monkeys just jumped on the car. And you can see in one of these pictures how these two young monkeys liked to play with this wire on Stuart's car, and he was trying to chase them off before they broke it. And the monkeys are basically just completely surrounding the car, sitting on the what is it, the not the lamp, what is that, the mirror on the side mirror of the car. But finally, they got off, and the way we went back, Stuart waved goodbye to every single monkey we saw on the way back down the mountain, down the rock. So it was
It's
just
a nice day.
beautiful. It was
It's a good day.
awesome.
Really good
Yes,
day.
there was a rainbow today, Simon.
Okay.
Today was
Yeah.
actually, as you noticed, maybe I didn't say it was a beautiful, gorgeous, sunny day in Gibraltar. It was actually very windy and rainy today. But on the positive side, we saw a beautiful rainbow because of the rain.
Good stuff. So it's lovely, lovely start to the day for you.
Yes.
This is good. Yeah.
So happy I got to visit my monkeys.
And they're quite friendly. I was speaking to one of the taxi drivers, and he mentioned the monkeys have got slightly more aggressive recently, but they're
Yeah.
friendly towards you lot. They like chess
Yeah.
players.
Oh, and we took all, we saw all these pictures with the chess pieces.
Okay.
They were afraid of the chess pieces.
They're afraid of the chess pieces.
Yeah, they were afraid when we brought them out, so I
Like
don't
a lot
know.
of chess players, I guess. So afraid of chess pieces. And it was a pretty horrible day as well. I mean, I guess you didn't get great views at the top of the rock
Well,
today.
we came there for the monkeys, not the
Okay.
views. So the
Good
monkeys
stuff.
were great. And you know what happened? I mean, well, we didn't show this picture, maybe another time, but a monkey jumped on my head. Okay. And then at some point, as I'm like sort of trying to balance him on there, a second monkey jumps on me because he's trying to fight with this monkey. And then they both jump off of me. So I was like a springing board for them. Yeah, okay. It was, you know, it's a little bit scary when the second one jumps on you and you think.
Do you think they saw one of their own?
Of course. Of course.
Yeah, good. Yeah, I miss that actually. I mean, the only time I saw the monkeys was 10 years ago now, I think, which was great. It was a lovely
sunny
day.
Wow, Simon.
I know. Well, I saw one this tournament, but it was only outside the hotel, so that was nice. But yeah, I would love to. It just seemed a bit too rainy today for me to go up. It's really
it was
been,
rainy and windy, but yeah. You know, we obviously it was not optimal conditions, you know,
yeah.
To go up there, but you go there and you still have a good time.
Yeah, definitely.
So.
And okay, well, maybe we should move on to some of the games then.
Yeah.
And okay, some very, as you mentioned, exciting encounters. And I suppose we should start with this board one game. And this could be the tournament decider, this game. Obviously, if Ivanchuk wins this game.
Yeah, he could get to his max, you know, to his peak score here of 9 out of 10.
Yeah.
It's still, still feasible for him if he wins today.
And if he wins today, I think he's pretty much guaranteed to have a share of first. I would say, wow, what's going on here with Kamsky? Look at that camera. Is he sort of, has he realized he's lost a pawn? Okay, well, that's a really,
you know,
really
he often actually takes that pose even when everything is fine and he's winning. I don't know why he does that. It looks like he's suffering intensely, but.
Has Kamsky just lost the pawn after four moves with the white pieces? Do you think it's that simple? I doubt it somehow. But let's go on to this game. So Ivanchuk, I'm surprised actually with the way Ivanchuk started this game because he didn't really need to play so aggressively. And Kamsky's played 2 bishop f4. And I suppose it's fair to say Kamsky is one of the world leading experts in the London system, would you say, Irina?
Yeah.
This move, which has got a rather dull reputation. And we actually tend to see this opening much more commonly played at lower level because white's setup is very, very sort of basic. And white generally just plays e3, knight f3, bishop d3, and kind of just plays a very passive setup. Ivanchuk's picked a very aggressive approach, played a very aggressive approach against this London system, c5. So, of course, d5 is a bit like a Tromposki here, and d5 would be a more aggressive approach, but instead Kamsky plays e3 again, a very solid move. And now, look at this. This is so brave from Ivanchuk. Ivanchuk's gone queen b6, so queen b6 attacking b2, and Kamsky's gone knight c3, and Ivanchuk's just taken this pawn. And this is amazing way to play when you're leading the tournament. After four moves, Ivanchuk's grabbed what looks like a very dangerous pawn.
Yep.
On b2.
Absolutely, Simon. In
very
fact,
dangerous.
I'm very curious what happens here on the move knight to b5.
Yeah, I mean, knight b5 looks extremely logical, and we can see that. I guess Ivanchuk's obviously not at the board, so you would have thought he's prepared this already. And Kamsky is now trying to work out what's happened here, really. I mean, it's so brave to just grab this pawn at b2. And
it's not that brave, Simon. It's obviously just what his computer told him.
Yeah.
it's less brave when...
Yeah, computers, yeah. Maybe it's a computer.
I mean, I think there's no way that he would go for this without having looked at it with his computer.
Sure. You have to, yeah. I mean, it's a computer move. Definitely.
Although he did spend some time, I mean, they've both spent some time, right?
Yeah, I mean, I heard Chucky doesn't really use a computer, but I don't know if I believe that. Someone told me he does not use a computer. I don't know how true that is. Does he use a computer? I really no idea. So, I mean, I imagine he must do, but his brain's kind of computer-like, so he must use a computer. Yeah, I know, but his brain's like a computer. Does he need a computer? He's like Houdini. Okay, he's maybe like the first version of Houdini. Not the latest version of Houdini. He's Houdini 1. Okay, maybe Magnus is Houdini 2. And Kasparov, maybe? What's Kasparov? Houdini 1.5?
Maybe Simon here, knight to d5.
Knight, this is a position we have on the board. What on earth is
that's actually what happened.
This
okay.
is not chess.
Yeah, no, it seems like the
chess.
Only move that made sense to me, because if you don't
it's
go...
Bizarre. What is it? What's this position? I don't understand this at all.
Right.
Yeah, okay, we've got Steve, who's in charge of live boards, and he's actually checking that two kids are not mucking around with the pieces on the live boards. And actually, this is not just being played as a Skittles game in the analysis room. It is actually the top board encounter. And one thing we sort of tend to see in Gibraltar, this is just winning. We tend to see this.
Because normally the black queen would want to go back via the b4 and a5 squares, you know, somewhere to safety. But over here, queen b4, c3, queen a5, knight c7 just, you know, leads into a nasty fork, doesn't it, Simon? Because over here, well, what's going on? You take the rook,
and
you can take here, and the king seems to run away, whites up a rook for now. Yeah, that's why I was thinking this position, because it's a little bit deceptive. White is not actually threatening to win the queen with the move rook b1, because normally this move would just be winning the queen. Here it's actually not, because the queen can take the a2 pawn. So that's why black has this move that defends the c7 square.
I mean, I was thinking bishop c4, knight takes f4, rook b1, but you go knight c3, which is very strong.
Bishop c4 right here?
Yeah, I mean, just my idea was knight takes f4. Knight c3 is a better move than rook b1.
Here. Right, you want to chop the queen.
But obviously black just goes knight to c3, which is a much superior move.
Knight
here.
To c3.
This is and now the queens have to come off. And even with the queens off, I mean, maybe white has some compensation. But
right, what's going on here, Simon, if I go knight c7 first and then play queen c1?
Sure. What on earth is going on here? I mean, queen b4, trying to get a draw? This is surely not chess. This is
the kind of positions you like, Simon.
It's the kind of positions I like, but I don't expect 2,700 players to play like this. I'd expect this to happen on board two, maybe Richard Report.
Right.
Not with Vanchuk, and this is just completely bizarre.
Well, let's just take a look at this.
C4. I mean, that last position.
Oh, you were saying queen takes c4.
Just try to just try to prove that. Maybe queen b4. Are you threatening any? I don't know.
Anything? Well, let's
knight
check.
Knight takes a2, I guess, is
yeah. Knight c3. Takes a2.
But maybe I just take on f7 with my bishop. Even I don't know. I just don't know. I mean, knight takes a2. I go c3.
Yeah. Well, all right. Well, knight d5. Mm-hmm. So what else do we have here other than bishop c4? Bishop c4 is unusual. So there's this move. Let's just take a look at it, because it's obvious.
Yeah, that looks very obvious.
Queen takes.
Such brave play by Vanchuk.
I don't know. You never know how brave it is. I mean, obviously, you know, white can... I wouldn't say that there's no chance that the game could end like this. I mean, it's very little chance, but I wouldn't say it's completely impossible.
Okay, and a draw is a good result for Vanchuk.
Yeah, I think so. I think you know, he knows that. And so I think his point is like, happy with a draw, but if white wants to take risk and play for more and he's got this analyzed, you know, he's fine with that too, you know?
Yeah.
So I think both scenarios are decent for him. Mm-hmm. And, you know, how does white play for a win here?
Good points.
Well, okay, let's just try this bishop c4 move. Or
I mean, I like rook b1 first, but maybe
rook
not.
Rook b1.
Yeah, maybe not rook. Or is just, I think you just take the bishop and it doesn't.
Yeah, you have so many pawns for the exchange there.
I mean, okay, let's have a look. Let's just have a think about this position. This is, completely bizarre. C4, you just take the bishop, obviously.
I want to just point out one thing too, Simon. There's a lot of cases also my queen can now come back to a5, so I don't know if your rook on driving my queen to a2 was so good.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't like knight
bishop,
c3.
But
I
bishop c4, you really just want to stop knight c3.
Yeah, I don't like knight c3. I don't want to. I think this knight on d5 could be a target at some point, so personally, I'd rather stop this knight coming.
But what's going on here? I mean, I guess the thing is that in this position, this is the critical position, isn't it, Simon?
Yeah. And now, okay.
How about?
I'd go. Just
how about this move? Bishop f7. Just take that pawn. Is there a dangerous discovered check? Well, this check is not dangerous because we can just block like that. What else can you do? You can try to take that. You can try going here, Simon. And then trying to win the knight on c7 and forcing the move c3. And then white has another move to do something, so that doesn't seem that dangerous.
Yeah, I mean, I
like your move, bishop c4. I feel like it has merit.
Okay, so complicated.
Someone said something useful to us, Simon.
Yeah, I think
we have a tweet.
Someone commented that according to GM pre-A. White is nothing better than forcing an early repetition in the line play by Ivanchuk. But I somehow doubt that. I mean, I'm sure White can, maybe the draw is computer's top choice, but I'm sure White can play some long-term strategy where he does sacrifice pawn and just play on. But obviously that's very risky against...
Yeah, you know, GM Prié is an expert on this line.
Yeah.
You know, he plays this kind of stuff for White.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Well...
But the question is...
Yes.
If you play this stuff as White,
And this surely you know something.
Be the critical line,
yeah.
Because Queen B6 and just take a pawn on B2 after four moves is critical. And if you're happy to have a draw after five moves of White, then why on earth are you playing this line with White? Surely you should do a bit better preparation than five moves. I mean, five moves preparation, even I can do that. You know, I think it's not too hard to actually prepare five moves in the game of chess. And why on earth is Kamsky preparing five moves if the best he can do is a draw? It's just ridiculous strategy. Because obviously Black's playing the game Queen B6, take on B2. I mean, what does he expect Black's going to do after Queen B6? If you look at move three, Black's gone Queen B6.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what do you think? He's going to go something else?
He had no other real way to defend the B2 pawn.
Yeah, I mean, White's strategy seems very passive. I mean, if you play E3, even E3 just seems like a passive move to me. You should go D5 if you want to try to get an advantage. So, if you're playing this line as White, you're obviously prepared for the move Queen B6. And then it's obvious Black's going to take on B2, and the best you have is a draw. And you have to draw a move after like eight moves of White, and the only way to win the tournament is to win. Then, that's extremely bad preparation.
Well, let's just see what happens, Simon, before we we say anything else. Yes,
it won't be too critical.
We'll see how this game develops. Let's take a look at board two.
Yeah, sure.
Not that much is going on there.
Okay, so board two is Maxime versus Richard Report. And Maxime has white pieces. So Maxime generally plays two openings. He plays either E4 or C4, some kind of English setup. So Richard, a very imaginative player. A win for Richard in this game would accelerate him to a very
good
position.
At least,
that'd be a great pairing for me. I'd love to see.
You see the Report versus Ivanchuk. That's what you want to see in the last round.
That'd be a great pairing.
If a Report wins, he can catch up to Ivanchuk if Ivanchuk draws.
That's right. And Richard may well have the white pieces. So, but of course, beating Maxime with black is very tough to do. And, this is a kind of typical-ish English. And, knight d4 is kind of unique here.
Yeah, it's a common idea. I mean, yeah. I don't know if I've seen it in this particular position, but it's pretty typical.
Yeah. So knight d4, it's not so crazy. Bishop g2, but combined with bishop e7, I don't know. This is a little bit odd.
Okay, but there we got something normal.
Okay.
Knight f6.
Yeah.
So what do we expect White to play here, Simon?
Well, I mean, if you'd like to, you could play... Knight. I'm just wondering if you should move the knights. Knight e1 or knight e5. Knight e5 may well. Then I've got queen a. Okay, I'm gonna try this move because if d6, I'm gonna go queen a4 check. Maybe. I want to go e3, but I don't know if this is a good idea. I'm not sure. It's a unique idea.
So d6, and you're saying queen a4 might be a problem for black.
Maybe. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
It's interesting. Interesting way to play.
Yeah, because on b5, you can play knight takes b5. That's your idea.
Yeah.
And this discovered check is at least very unpleasant. Well, okay, everything hangs in black's position here. So there's no b5. Mm-hmm. Should I play d6? I find this move a little bit like... Knight e5, a little bit dubious. I feel like the knight's going to be difficult to maintain on that square.
This could get very tactical now. I mean, I'm
thinking about f4?
Well, I was thinking about some crazy idea of e3, but I don't think e3 is good. I just wanted to try to expose your queen on e5. Mm.
B3.
Okay. This is a much more sensible setup from White. And I mean, generally white sort of plays e3 in this type of position, just puts bishop on b2, maybe takes on, I mean, if, I guess black's whole idea of playing e6 is to go d5.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, otherwise, why'd you put your pawn on e6? I mean, I don't know if he plays it now, but let's say he plays it straight away. Let's say bishop takes and go d5.
Mm-hmm.
This would seem to be the idea behind black's e6, knight f6 idea. Maybe
it could be a bit worse for black, no? I mean, you take on d5. I mean, I would always prefer to play white.
Sure. And you're going to go d4. Yeah. And isolated pawns position, but mm-hmm. black doesn't seem to have too many active pieces here.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I wouldn't be that happy here with black, you know. Maybe it's okay, but it doesn't seem like his style of position either.
No.
So I think, you know, I mean, just looking at the way this game is developing, obviously it's very early to really say anything, but it seems like it's a pretty decent opening idea by Vachier. He's just going for a certain type of position.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, simple position, nothing. You know, it's interesting because actually he's a very tactical player as well, but in this game, he's choosing just to play a quiet game.
Yeah.
So he's trying to play more against what he perceives as the weaknesses of his opponents, I think.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think he's picked quite a clever line here because Maxi, well, they're both very flexible players, and we've seen Richard Reports has played great attacking chess and other kind of chess. But, you know, this is going to heat up later on, I think. It's one of those games which takes a little bit of warming up, like a bad car engine on a winter's day. So, okay, let's move to another board, shall we? What about board three? So, board three, we have Mickey Adams. Okay, so let's see how Mickey get back into a contention to play. I mean, Mickey, I guess these guys, I mean, if we look at the score group, the people on 6 points really need to win both their games now to have any chance of a playoff. Even then, it depends what happens in Chucky's game. Let's say Chucky draws today. I'm just saying maybe this is the most likely result. 7.5, and he's got, and then who knows what Chucky will do tomorrow. I think 8 points is going to be the minimum winning score. It could well be 8.5, but I think 8 points, you have a chance to get in the playoff.
Everyone with six really needs to win both games.
Yeah, they do. So if you're in a group of 6 points, you've got to take risks today.
Yeah.
And, Mickey's playing a very strong Indian player, young Indian player who had in yesterday.
21 years old.
21, wow. And I'm sure he's going to be much higher rated very soon. And okay, so Mickey's decided to play open Sicilian, knowing that he needs to win the game.
And so Black's, the Paulson.
Yeah, and Black's so well prepared, I think we realised when he came into contrary yesterday. He seems to know all his theory up to like move
20 something.
And 20 something, in this kind of slightly obscure line. So we know that Black's going to be well prepared, but I think Mickey's kind of choice is quite sensible because Mickey's just picking a kind of position he's very comfortable playing, would you say? You know, he's not going for any sort of too tactical variation. He's just going to play a position, you know? And, okay, so what do we have? Standard kind of position after b5 here. So I guess both sides are still in theory.
I mean, I've never seen this particular position, so they might be in theory. I'm out of theory.
Sure.
G3, a6, bishop g2. I think the move, you know, I know about is like d6, castles, and, you know, bishop d7, and then knight f6.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of develop your queen side quickly because you want to make sure. I think there's some trick, like if you don't do this, where they can, let me try to show you the trick. Let's say black plays without bishop d7, they go knight f6, and white plays rook e1, and black plays bishop e7, so this looks very sensible for black, you know. But then white's whole concept revolves around this move where they try to break up your strong pawns in the center using this tactic that you cannot take the rook because white would take the c6 pawn and then the rook on a8. And so the evaluation here is that white is better, you know, because, okay, obviously those pawns in a6, c6 are a bit weak. The bishop on c8 still needs to be developed. So white has, you know, white is playing bishop f4 quickly. So white's better in this position. So that's what, you know, you have to be careful about in this line. So that's why when you play d6 and white castles, you know, you take time to play this move, bishop d7, so that if white takes on c6, you can capture back with the bishop. You don't have to worry about your pawn structure getting spoiled. And then if white would play the same thing, you know, then you can just go, you know, knight f6. And, you know, white has big choice of plans here. You know, they often retreat their knight to b3 so that there are no exchanges of knights. Right, Simon? That's common. So,
yeah.
Or maybe do they ever bring the knight back to e2?
Mm-hmm.
In these positions, right. So, I mean, I'm just saying that I have never actually seen this move, knight g7, even though I play this line for black. It's
right,
a little bit of a news for me.
Okay. Makes a lot of sense as well, I guess. I mean, often you maybe just want to swap on d4 and go knight c6, and the knight is not so bad on e7.
But then the question is, why didn't that happen? Because, yeah you would think that that's the main idea of knight e7. Is to do that, but that we didn't see that happen.
Right.
So why is that, Simon? I guess the bishop has to retreat.
Yeah, probably to e3.
What about b5?
Okay.
This looks reasonable for black, except there's one little problem. Yes, there's one problem here, which is this typical Sicilian move.
Yeah.
This is kind of unpleasant, isn't it, Simon? Because over here, I wonder a little bit about how unpleasant this is. Obviously, the idea is that you want to try to win the rook on a8. Now, first thing is that I have this type of move. I don't really believe in this, but we can try it.
Queen d5, huh?
Queen d5, knight c6.
Now bishop.
You've got queen e4.
Yeah.
D8 reminds me of the Vachier game. You think that white is doing well here, that there should be some way to mate. Don't you think, Simon?
Sure, yeah.
Like, you know what I would be looking at here? I mean, maybe just castles.
Mm-hmm.
Or, this is a d6 pawn.
Maybe you don't need to check on e4 straight away. I mean, the other options go sort of bishop c5, potentially something, you know, and just try to play like, black's got a very cramped position, so let's just put a rook on e1, take on f7 with our queen.
Right, that makes sense, Simon.
You know.
Yeah.
And I really don't like black's position. Even though black's piece up, all these horrible pieces cramped, looks very bad. So.
Well, one question, Simon. I was actually wondering, what if I made a very solid move here, like bishop to e7,
develop
or actually to d6? Yeah. Let's just develop a piece. I'm going to give you back the knight.
Okay.
But I want to see if you have a lot in that kind of position with two minor pieces already exchanged.
No, I mean, it looks very comfortable. I think black.
You think so? You got to take?
Probably comfortable.
You got to take because otherwise I move my knight away. Yeah. You think black is okay here?
Maybe white has some edge. Bishop on g2 is a very good piece.
Mm.
And all you need to do is give Mickey a little advantage and
he's
very comfortable.
You know, this move would have been very strong. It would be very strong if in chess you had to take the pieces that your opponent offered you. Of course, this is a very nice position for white. But the problem is black does not have to take that bishop. They respond with this counter check.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and probably black is okay, right, Simon?
Yeah.
Anyway, but you don't have to, of course, play this move b5, allowing all those sacrifices. Maybe you can just go bishop e7.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I guess it's pretty standard stuff as well, but I mean, black really has to watch out for knight to d5. And I mean, the position they got in the game, I mean, this is after b5. I mean, if we just have a look at this, what's happening here. So, I mean, I think black's playing very quickly at the moment. So, it's quite an interesting position, this, because obviously black's already got this knight to c4, which is quite useful in the Sicilian, pawn to b5. But the king's on e8 and the bishop's on f8, so I'm just wondering if there's any way white can take advantage of this. So, it's not entirely clear how. I mean, ideas of obviously knight d5 again.
Well, what about somewhere b3, bishop b2? Is that possible?
Yeah, that's a very sensible way to play b3. You've got some knight e3 move? I don't know. Knight e3
You're so far behind in developments. I feel like the whole strategy of blacks has been just a little bit dubious.
Well, let's try knight e3.
Yeah,
maybe.
Bishop takes.
So bishop takes, then I take on c3.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to go bishop. Queen on c3 could be Could be quite useful there.
And queen e2.
Queen e2, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're going to rook to d1. And this is looking quite harmonious for white here, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, yeah, good happy position for white. So b3, yeah, b3 is very sensible. Very sensible move. And just trying to force this knight away, which makes what about bishop b4 then? I'm just trying to think of some way to take it. Oh, then knight takes, maybe knight takes b4. Mm. So bishop b4 is trying to, I think if black's whole strategy after b3 was just to retreat the knight,
mm-hmm.
then black's strategy has gone wrong. So I think black will be trying to use some tactics maybe.
Oh, he did play b3, Simon.
He did play b3, yep. Okay. Well, b3 is very logical. And now it's really, you know, if black has to retreat the knight on c4, I do not like black's position. Because black's, I mean, they got this rule, haven't they, in the opening, where you should not move the same piece more than once in the opening. And, you know, because it loses time.
Well, the funny thing is black has only moved his knights, right, Simon? He's taken two moves to put the knight on g6. He's taken three moves to put the knight on c4. So, I mean, to me, it just looks, of a dubious idea. I mean, I can understand the move knight e7 if your point is to take on d4 and put it on c6 with tempo.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, I mean, it does surprise me a little bit, all this knight moving around. Yeah.
I had a similar game, actually, in some Sicilian, which I lost at Hastings Congress, one of the longest ever running chess tournament in the world. And in a Sicilian, I also end up putting my knight on g6. I just got tricked in the opening. And actually, I mean, your knight on g6, I found, is just nearly always a bad piece. It's only good if white tries to, barge through with a move f5, because then your knight goes to the e5 square. But generally, this knight on g6, when you're playing, especially against pawn on g3, is completely cut out of the game. So I don't like the positioning of this knight on g6 in general. And blacks just seem to waste a lot of tempo by moving his knights around. So I think the only way to justify this would be something like bishop to b4 here, and try to attack this knight on c3. This looks like maybe a tactical justification. And as we know, black is very well prepared, and I'm sure he's analysed this on the computer. So this is horrible. This is absolutely horrible. Are we going to get a draw on board one?
Yeah, we are.
No, come on. We can't have a draw on board one. This is, I can understand Ivanchuk taking a draw, he's half point clear, he's black.
And he played cleverly in the opening.
I mean, Kapski's quite a big guy, you know, can I criticise him? Can we get in the room and I can criticise him to throw his draw with white? Do I dare? I don't know, we can't.
He's playing the London system.
I mean, he's playing the London system.
Well, why don't you can invite him in here and maybe we can talk to him. We could ask him, you know, what he was thinking and, you know, how what happened to his preparation and, you know.
Sure, I want to know what he's thinking, but I don't know. I mean, obviously a great player, but maybe he's just been tricked in the opening.
Yeah, that happens.
I don't know, he could play on, actually, maybe he will play on. I mean, okay, board one is certainly one of the most interesting openings, and hopefully it's not a draw. Hopefully, I'm just really hoping this game's not going to be a draw on board one. Sorry?
Did he make rook b1 then?
He's played rook b1 quick. Okay, I'll just show you the last couple of moves very quickly. And this is the top board clash. Well, he went rook b1, queen takes a2. And I think this position, okay, black is two pawns up. And I think white can, you know, white. Okay, he's gone rook a1, queen b2. So this is what happened, you know. So a draw is immediate, rook b1. This is immediate draw, but I just really hope this doesn't happen. Well, yeah, I mean, black's obviously very well prepared, and Kamsky's not looking happy. Maybe it's just good preparation for black, and Kamsky, after playing free queen b6, did not expect his opponent to play queen takes b2. It strikes me as very strange. So I don't know. I mean, if your opponent goes queen b6 and move 3, you should honestly be expecting to take a pawn and move 4. I don't know. It's very, very, very peculiar. Very peculiar. We'll see. I mean, just look at the webcam here. If we just see Kamsky's face, he's actually looking rather embarrassed. And I know he normally goes to the gym after the game, Irina, so I don't really want him to have his workout on me, you know, if I question him too hard. And maybe it's just bad preparation. Could just be bad preparation from white. And I'm sure Kamsky wanted to play a game against Ivanchuk.
Sure.
Here, and I'm sure he did not want to go, you know, move on. So, okay. Well, let's move on to another game, because that could easily be a draw very quickly, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So, Irina, there's a very interesting move here played between Mohamed Al-Sayed, who had a great victory yesterday against Alexander Fier from Brazil against Bolligan. Mm-hmm. So Bolligan, we haven't seen much of Bolligan so far. And Bolligan's an expert, well, he's written a very good book on the King's Indian Defence. And here we see a very interesting idea. If we just jump forwards a little bit to, I believe it's move 11, where, okay, Bolligan, this knight c6 moves is a bit sort of strange, really, mm-hmm. would you say? I mean, the normal move here, instead of knight c6, is something like b6, bishop b4, check, something along these lines. But knight c6 is a little bit peculiar, mm-hmm. a little bit peculiar in this position. So g3, very
But sometimes,
solid.
I mean, it transposes into something, Simon, because there's this line, isn't there this line where bishop b4, let's look at that, bishop b4, bishop d2, queen e7, g3, and is black queen knight c6, yes, bishop g2, bishop takes d2.
Yeah.
And now the idea is that if white captures with the queen, then there's knight e4.
Sure.
And queen b4 coming on the next move is a little bit problematic.
Yeah.
Right, there's a problem there with defending all the central pawns suddenly.
Yeah.
And that's why the knight has been developed to c6.
Sure. And so you normally take them d2 with a queen because your knight's on b1.
Yes, would rather go on c3. Yeah.
So
queen d2, knight e4. I mean, it's a possible line, but I mean, this is black's idea that he creates an inconvenience to white with his check.
Yeah.
And white does not have an easy way to meet this because, you know, all these developing moves, well, unfortunately, you know, after these things happen, you lose a pawn on d4. So that's kind of black's idea behind putting the knight on c6.
Yeah.
So what white generally does in this position, well, they have to take on d2 with the knight. So black, by putting the knight on c6, which it's actually not its best square,
mm-hmm.
But he has put white's knight on not his best square either. And then something like this happens here, 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 here. And we can see this knight, you know, it's not so happy on c6. White wins a tempo by attacking it, and now it goes back to b8. I recently had actually a rapid game like this.
I had a game with this as well, with white against Isitrescu,
mm-hmm.
who recently played in the London Classic, and I thought white's best plan here. Mm-hmm. It's very strange because both sides have to lose tempo
mm-hmm.
by moving their knight. So black's got to.
You thought knight b1 to c3?
Yeah. And black has to go knight b8 here, really.
Mm-hmm. Right.
C5 is the normal square for this knight.
Yeah.
And white's knight on d2 should really be on the c3 square. Actually, I went knight b1 to...
This is another plan for white. It's quite popular, knight e1.
Yeah, so there's a lot of misplaced pieces.
I think the problem, though, if you try this move immediately, Simon, isn't the problem bishop g4?
Maybe e4 is dropping as well. So I go queen c2 first.
Queen c2, right.
Plan. It's also good to see our tournament director in the room, Stu Conquest. I was saying, Stu, you're here, aren't you? Yeah, you're here, yeah. The monkey in the middle hasn't said much, but yeah, Stuart's actually in the room as well, so. Hi, Stuart. And how's the tournament going, Stuart? Everything going well now?
Good, yeah.
It seems to be going brilliantly so far, and
good atmosphere upstairs.
Great, yeah, great atmosphere and great evening events, and the masterclass was great yesterday, Maxine.
Maxine was awesome.
Maxine,
was brilliant.
Yeah.
There's a lot of very good feedback from people here. Said it was one of the best, or maybe the best.
Brilliant.
Really first class.
Very good.
First class.
Yeah. So obviously, Maxine Legrave did the masterclass here, and this is saved on the website. So I think you can access it and go back and look at his thoughts. And did he do a couple of games? He went over a couple of games.
He did one game and sort of one and a half games, and he also took questions from the audience. It was great.
Brilliant. Okay. Good to hear. So yeah, have to have a look at that as well.
So I think what we're seeing in this game, Alcide Bolligan, is actually going to be quite similar to what we're looking at here in these variations, Simon.
Yeah, sure.
So Bolligan, yeah, he made an unusual move, knight c6, white plays g3, but then it starts to transpose, right? Because, except white played knight c3 instead of bishop g2. Okay, right, well, it is different, yes. There is this move, knight c3, and white does not allow the trade of dark squared bishops.
Mm-hmm.
Castles here, d6, castles. And e5.
Okay, e5.
What do you think would happen on the move knight e4, Simon?
I think knight e4 actually is a very standard move here. And, obviously I'm a Dutch player. And if I go knight e4, you know what, I'm going to play f5 next move. And this is going to be quite a... This will be the way I'll be very tempted to play.
Do you think white will just go queen c2?
I mean, or maybe bishop e1.
I thought, is it worth saving that bishop or not? The problem is bishop e1, I'm not sure how we get rid of the knight on e4.
I'll just say, we've got some very interesting people in the audience today. So Malcolm Payne, hello. Just have to say hello. So, and Malcolm, you're going to Bunratty as well, are you? So, chess tournament.
Unfortunately, I can't make Bunratty.
Oh, you can't make Bunratty.
To my eternal shame and great sadness.
Oh, really? I'm sad to hear that.
So is the barman.
Okay. I don't know. I mean, knight e4 must be another logical way to play. Mm. I mean, it just depends on your preference, really.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, as a Dutch player, I'd be very tempted to go knight e4 and f5.
Mm-hmm.
But this g5 move is quite fascinating at bottom.
Right, so let's take a look at that. Knight b8.
Knight b8.
Knight h4.
Tenth and g5 now. This is really, you know, very interesting decision that Black's played, because obviously g5 is by no means forced. And it's very committal to move g5. I mean,
why do you think he hurried with this move, Simon? It's because white is threatening e4, isn't it?
Maybe e4. Maybe black's just worried that white's going to get a very nice position unless he does something quite drastic here.
Right.
But I mean, I'll be honest. I mean, I'm very in chess. I'm often play very committal moves, and I don't necessarily play long-term positional plans. But g5 is not a move I would really consider playing here. It looks. I mean, it looks too weakening to the black king. I don't know. Very committal. I don't know. What do you reckon, Irene, about this?
I don't know. I mean, I know you probably think it's not my style of move, right? But I don't feel too negatively about it. Because, I mean, if you look at this position, white wants to play e4 in the next move, eventually prepare the move f4. Mm. White has more space, the bishop pair. So I think black actually, you know, black's position looks solid, but it's actually quite passive,
yeah.
Right? I think they have to do something drastic to change things. That's why the move g5 doesn't really surprise me very much. I mean, what other move could they possibly make?
I think white's got a very good setup. I remember Tony Miles used to play sort of similar kind of thing as black, this knight c6 idea sometimes. But I mean, well, you've got to try f5 as black.
Let's look at this terrible move.
Oh, I don't, yeah.
Simon, what if we try it so radically?
Hello, bishop on c3.
I'm actually threatening g5 here, and I want to trap your knight.
I just want to trap my knight.
Yeah, so I mean, let's just look at that for a second.
Well, if you ever go g5, we've got queen d4 maybe, but I don't know. What about just f3? I just want to try to open up your position.
Right.
f3. I'm not too worried about losing my piece.
You're not worried.
No, I'm
You're
not worried.
Worried.
I'm worried about this piece.
Okay.
Maybe I even take on e4 here.
Okay.
I like this just...
Yes. Well, you do get a tempo. If I play g5 now, you take on e4, you gain a tempo on my knight and f6.
Now my knight comes to f5. So,
yes.
Okay, so we had the webcam on this fascinating... Is that the right word?
Yeah. Fascinating repetition.
Can I just say struggle? This struggle on board one. And, I think this is heading towards a perpetual on move 9, a draw on move 9, which is, great for Chucky, really. I mean, Chucky will still remain in first place, potentially on his own with the white pieces in the last round. And honestly, I think Kamsky's just been tricked into this line. And what I find absolutely amazing about this line is that the first three moves from Ivanchuk were knight f6 and d5, queen b6. And what can you possibly be intending after going queen b6, queen takes pawn? And surely when you're doing preparation with the white pieces, the first move you should look at is your opponent taking a pawn for free. I just don't understand it. It looks like a forcing line. And I think now Kamsky, it's heading towards just a draw before move 10. And I think it's just a hole maybe in Kamsky's repertoire. And one thing Ivanchuk's very good at doing, I mean, he plays so many different openings.
Yeah.
He just has such a wide range of openings. He can play anything to such a high level. And I think he's just picked a very good line here that maybe he's noticed Kamsky has made a mistake of falling into in the past. And obviously, here comes the draw. He does not look happy. I'm sure Kamsky did not want to have a draw here with white. And unfortunately, here we go. They're shaking hands now, as you can see on the webcam. And it looks like they're okay. Well, he's got his hands on his eyes. You can see by the body language, this is certainly not what Kamsky wanted. So I will not be inviting Kamsky in the commentary room. I think it's a bit too quick. And well, I think he's wait. Yeah, I think is this a draw? Yeah, the board's been set up. He looks very disappointed. Yeah, of course he's going to be disappointed with the white pieces. Just tricked into this opening, but. What do you expect when you play the London system?
Well, I mean, the idea of c5 and queen b6 is pretty typical in those positions. So it is just a bit surprising, especially since he's played it so many times with white.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good result for Chucky.
Yeah, no, I think so. For black, it's totally good for his tournament position.
Of course. And I'm sure this wasn't prearranged, obviously. It's just, it was really just, you can't prearrange a draw with Chucky, can you? It's impossible. So, but I think he's just been tricked with his opening here, unfortunately. And a pity about that ball one clash, but plenty of other interesting games to concentrate on. So, not the end of the world for us here as commentators.
Simon, do you mind if I just try this move in this position? I'm still interested in trapping that knight.
I know, positionally, this kind of looks horrible.
I agree. I've opened up your dark squared bishop.
I mean, I don't know.
Probably something like f4.
Maybe just queen d3, potentially, as well.
Queen d3.
I like queen d3 to go
f5, yes, that's a simple move.
I just think the bishop on c3 is looking like a monster. So, that looks extremely strong, the queen on d3.
I agree. Once the knight comes to f5, you're clearly better.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, so, well, I mean, it's just, it's important to show our viewers why it's not good to overextend pawns, right? The pawn, when it goes to e4, separates itself from the other pawns, and in the end becomes a weakness. And I like your move f3 a lot, because it's a way to open up the f-file for the rook, to get your knight maybe to the f5 square, get all these pieces working together.
And
it just seems very effective if black takes the pawn on f3. Well, maybe that's what black should do.
Sure.
What would you do here? Probably just,
I'd still take the pawn.
You take with the pawn?
I'm really not worried about
g5. You're really not worried.
I'm going to go queen d4 and rook a1.
Knight f5. Knight f5. Yes, you've provoked me into allowing that.
Yeah.
Oh, Gatha. Okay. I'm so happy to see you.
I'm scared now. Okay, so.
Do you want to come and talk to us for a few minutes?
Do you want to just talk through your
Because you haven't come to see us at all, so we'll forgive you if you come talk to us.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
You can.
I'll run away.
Right.
If we can, maybe you need a mic though, this is the only possibility. Okay, so if you want to join us here, squeeze in. So.
Yeah. So tell us when we're ready to start.
So we'll have a quick toilet break.
Go on.
Yeah, let me do that. I'll try to join in anyway.
It's probably for sale.
Okay, fine. So
are we ready to start?
Yeah.
Okay. So Gata, welcome to the commentary room.
Okay, thank you.
What made you decide to visit us today?
Well, it was a very short game and I felt that I had to explain what happened this time.
Yeah.
I played this line before, but c5, I looked at it, and then e3, and then I completely forgot about the queen b6, and I analyzed it a while back, and I didn't remember anything.
Right.
I remember that I had to play knight c3, which makes sense because there is no way to hold the b2 pawn.
Right, because in these kinds of positions, you never want to make a move like b3.
Right.
It weakens the whole diagonal. Right, so knight c3 is the principal move.
Right, queen a2, and then I realized that I completely don't remember anything. And there were only two moves here, knight a4, knight b5. Knight a4 is obviously not that great.
Because the queen can just go back to a5, right?
Right, queen. And
c3 and
doesn't stand well.
And yeah, you can't even try to take this pawn because you lose this one. So knight b5 looks critical.
Knight b4 is the only move, and knight d5, that's the main move. And and he managed to hit my bishop on f4 and cover the c7 square, and then a lot of things are coming, like also knight c3 and a6. So rook b1 is actually only move.
And only can I ask you something, Gatsa?
Yeah.
Simon and I, you know, not knowing this position very well, we tried to look at this move.
Queen b4 check.
Oh, this is a bishop. Right. I'm sorry, why didn't anyone point this out earlier? Right. You know, we were like, oh, you know, knight c3, and we started looking at, knight c7 and queen c1, but
right.
You said there's queen b4.
Queen
b4 wins the bishop,
no, but rook b1 makes sense because, you know, I force him to take pawn on a2, and
right.
Then rook to back to a1, and now any a6 and rook on a8 is pinned, so in a way this is good for white. And I was trying to make bishop g3 here work,
right.
And there are a lot of lines here, like, I don't remember what I analyzed, but I remember black was okay here. So he can play even c4 here, same reason I cannot take on the c4, because queen b4 check. And black also has a6 and cd4, and all those moves are playable because he is up two pawns and any exchange of the queens. Even if I win an exchange, you know, black still has two pawns, so
right.
That there is a lot of risk involved. And since you know,
I since just he didn't have anything prepared,
point,
yeah,
for nothing, so
yeah.
I decided, you know, just cut my losses and fight another day.
Right.
Because
yeah.
You know, Vasily, he looked really determined today, and
determined to make that draw,
no,
black.
No,
and to beat you,
I
if you.
He actually came to play for a win, and this shows that he was ready to take some risks, and
yeah.
And I was just like, okay, right.
Let's get out of his way. Yeah. So tell us about your tournament here in general. Okay, obviously this game is a bit disappointing, but how do you feel it's been going in general?
Well, I was pretty lucky so far with all my parents.
We liked your game yesterday. Wasn't that very nice? I liked your bishop e6 move to g8.
Yeah, I was surprised, but that was actually first line.
Yeah?
Yeah. And
because it seemed very clever. You were avoiding the bishop trade. In the end, that bishop won the game for you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Well, I'm just saying, I appreciated that move, yes.
Yes. But okay, I play very solid here. I make my fair share of mistakes, but a lot of people are playing fighting chess here, which is good. And I tried to do my best, but as in the round against Alex Andreev before, I also played this. Because
mm-hmm.
I didn't know what to do against the Karo Khan that he plays. And I see a lot of Karo Khans in this tournament, like very hard to break. So this, I stick with what I know, and I know this opening more or less, except today's queen b6, which was, I haven't met this move in many years now, so something. Okay, so I'll go and think about it, and tomorrow, obviously, I'll play black.
Are you going to the gym now, Gato?
Okay.
I saw you yesterday after the game. It looked like you were on your way to the gym.
Well, it's important to keep yourself in physical shape. I mean, 10 rounds is a solid tournament.
Yeah.
It's tough. And I'm getting older, so, you know.
You know, we have a special guest commentator in this room today.
Okay.
Do you think you can find who it is? Like, just look very carefully. Look closer to you, like around, like within just a couple, like a 1 or 2 feet, 1 or 2 feet away from you, Gata. No, you're look.
Oh, this guy?
See, I knew you would find him.
Oh,
yeah.
Because I got a hint. Thanks.
Oh, you gave him a hint. Yes,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yes. Well, Gata, thank you for joining us,
okay.
And hopefully, you know, you'll do well tomorrow, and we can talk to you again.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Yes.
Would he have had to consult with the arbiter about
taking that job? I mean, I don't know what the rule about that is exactly. Do you have to consult?
They didn't.
I mean, usually the top players, you know, they make that decision for themselves and no one really says anything to them.
Yeah,
because I mean, in reality, what's the arbiter going to tell you? You know, what is he going to know better? Oh, look.
Okay. And now we have Ivanchuk joining us.
Yeah. Yes.
I don't mind. Do you want to just pull it out?
Yeah. Here, so do you want to?
Yeah. Sure. And how was your game today, then, first of all?
Okay, it was quite a quick draw, but I think it's interesting for Sivri. I don't know if it was happened before or not.
Yeah,
I didn't check it.
And has this context been played before? I mean, when you just grab this pawn?
No.
No, it's not been played. It's a very strange position after knight to d5, yes.
Yes, knight d5, yes.
This is a unique position after five moves so far.
Yes.
And
so you check, it was no game after queen takes b2.
There are a few games. Games being played in this position. So, okay. Can we ask if you use a computer when you prepare?
Okay. I'm using like database, but
sure. Okay, but it's more feeling, yeah. So okay. Well, you're in a good position now. So
sorry.
You're in a good position in the tournament. You're positioned well. You think with white tomorrow? Yeah.
I don't know. There is no drawing of lots yet.
Let's see, and obviously Gibraltar. You've been to Gibraltar many times.
Many, third times.
Now. Okay, and I remember commentating 2 years ago on your amazing performance when you got 9 out of 10, and this was a brilliant tournament you had in Gibraltar, and you know, it went very well, and you just seemed to destroy the whole field. So you're comfortable here in Gibraltar playing?
Okay, I like to play here. I like very much atmosphere here. Yeah. Many spectators, many interesting people, many different tournaments.
Sure. And what about the other games? Do you think there's any other players here, any other games you're interested in, for example? And if we bring up the board two game, let's just have a look at possible opponents of yours tomorrow. So this is Maxime's game, is white against Richard's board.
C4, knight c3, g3, knight d4 here.
Yeah.
Something new for me. Knight d4. Bishop g2, bishop e7. Strange, knight d4.
You think knight d4 is rather peculiar?
Strange, okay. I'm not claiming that bad, but.
Yeah.
Okay, it's. White surely. Okay, white is better. I cannot tell much better or slightly better, but it's surely unpleasant to play with black this position.
Okay, because of the bishop on g2?
White has initiative for nothing.
Okay, and what would you say is your best game you played in this tournament? The game you're most happiest with?
Okay, tomorrow is last round. It's completely possible my best game will be tomorrow.
Okay, yeah. Well, we'd like to see that. So, and hopefully you have the white pieces tomorrow as well. So
okay, we'll see. Okay, there is no drawing of lots. which comment I can to do?
Would you mind me asking? I mean, like, everyone prepares in different ways for tournaments, so I think most of the young players here, they tend to use computers and, you know, quite heavily in their preparation. Do you have a particular way that you prepare your games? Do you have a system when you play tournaments?
Okay, it depends. I can admit that sometimes computer can be useful, but sometimes also can bring damage if not used in correct way. So.
And okay.
It's a difficult question. Okay, everything in our life has some advantages and some disadvantages too.
Of course, yeah. And so it's going to be a very exciting last round anyway. Were there any other interesting variations in your game today? I mean, could he have played on any particular way at all in the final position? You think it's too risky for him to play on?
Yes, it's possible to play, but he is already 2 pawns down, and if nothing concrete, it means take serious risk. Of course, now white can consider knight g2 with some compensation, but
very complicated game.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, great stuff. So. Has there been any other players in the tournament you've been quite impressed with so far? I mean, their performances, or any particular game that's struck you as a very interesting game?
For sure, it were many good games, but now to remember.
Yeah. This is going to help us with maybe the best game prize. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Okay, so if I need to see a list of games. Okay.
Sure. But
Okay, but tough to say anyway. So
interesting novelty was played in game Dubov against Pardo in the line of g4.
This one.
Yes, yes.
Where black sacrificed the piece.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
I don't know is it correct or.
So we, but, I think this was.
But at least was quite interesting.
Yeah, I mean, if we just point this out, this was a very, very aggressive line from both sides.
Yes.
We
had, knight f3, knight d7, g4, and now knight takes g4. It takes d4, surprisingly. Yeah. Knight takes d4, knight c5, yes.
And now f3.
F3, knight takes g4.
And this is where black play knight takes f3. This is a game, yeah, very,
yes,
very interesting.
Yes, this is, which I was impressed.
Yeah, it's sharp stuff, and maybe not been played before, so very interesting. Yeah. I talked to Dubov about this game, and he said, I think he doesn't use his computer. He claimed not to use the computer much as well in the morning. Mm. He has an idea about what to play, and he plays his opening.
Mm-hmm.
But this knight takes g4, very interesting. So, so it's good. So you're excited about tomorrow?
Okay, I will wait, drawing of lots, and then...
Yeah, let's see what happens. So how are you going to relax now?
Okay, if rain finish it, maybe I will go for a walk a little bit.
Okay, good.
Maybe you can ask about some other games that we have.
Sure, of course. Think? Yeah. Let's have a look. So, is there any game you'd like to look at, particularly?
So, Adams Adhiban. So, g3, a6, bishop g2, knight g7. Another quite rare line. As I know, according to theory, knight b3 considered like the best for white.
Okay.
Bishop e3, knight e5, castle, knight g6, b5, b3, a4, b4. Okay, it looks like white is slightly better because black still has some problem with development, and both knight not placed well. So queen b2. So okay, it's better for white, but of course it's more or less typical Sicilian and complicated games.
Yeah, very. So maybe Mickey has some small edge, and if we just close this down, we can look at the position.
Oh,
the Bologna game. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
If we close this first.
Close it.
And
okay.
Just click on.
So, Ganguly Vitugo. Bologan.
Right, right. He played this g5 move on.
So, Bogo India. knight c3, castle, bishop. This. D6. Bishop c3. D5. Knight b8. Knight h4. Quite unusual.
Now g5 is played.
Yes. Sure. More natural looks knight d2 here, but okay. Knight g4, a little bit provocative move. g5, knight e4. Okay, it's quite logical. He wants to play f5. He has a big experience in King's India, so g5, f5. It's
sure, just push the pawns and attack, yeah?
Yes, so queen c2, takes, bishop g4. Bishop g4, I'm not so sure, maybe knight d7, for example, possible.
Mm-hmm.
So black has white choice, c5, okay, knight d7, c6, takes. Okay, sharp position, and now white has choice. Who will take? If queen takes c6, probably knight b6. If pawn takes c6, also knight b6. Okay, very complicated game. Okay,
yeah.
All the result is possible.
Yeah, okay, very double-edged.
Yes.
How about some of the ladies' games?
Okay.
Ladies, Muzichuk.
What's your favorite for the ladies'
one.
Prize, Ivanchuk?
Sorry?
Who's your favorite for the ladies' prize?
Oh, okay. So, bishop bf4. So, more popular, of course, bishop g5, but okay, bishop f4.
This is the Blumenfeld.
Yes,
habit, so
okay, I know. Okay.
So,
queen a5, check. Okay.
Yeah.
Bishop d2, queen b6, into bishop 7. Well, e4, bishop, cannot take because queen e2, so bishop e7, okay.
This could be some danger for black here,
okay, it
looks... double-edged.
I think it should be better for white after natural bishop d3, for example, because bishop usually in Benoni plays it better on g7. Mm-hmm. So if sometimes white can push a4, so I prefer white in this position.
Okay.
But okay, it's a complicated game.
Yeah. And this is bishop f4. This is I haven't seen this move so often myself, but I guess it's a normal move nowadays.
Yeah. Mm, yes, it's interesting. Yeah. So another Yelakhlishvili, another ladies.
Okay. Yeah.
Ah, so, sorry.
Yeah, that's okay.
Oh, it's already endgame. Sorry.
Already endgame. Wow. Uh-huh. Lots of moves here. So.
So okay. Knight f6, f4, it's a little bit rare line, more popular long castle now, so f4, bishop b4, bishop b3, knight f5, a6, d5, e5, knight e4, knight b3.
So there's only two ladies, I think, on this in the joint lead at the moment on 6 points, so I think if either the ladies can get a result, that's put them in a great position.
So, okay. What is this? Knight c4 takes opposite color bishop. Okay, now if white wants draw knight d2, it's possible, but white is pretending for something more.
Yeah.
f5 takes castle, rook, f5, rook f3, rook h3, bishop b7. Okay. Positional threat bishop d5 and knight will be
bishop
sat.
d5 is
yes,
the
and
positional.
Knight
put this bishop on the strong central side.
Yes.
Play against the knight on
f5. This g4 king d7.
Okay. So this is the current position we have, and I believe black got a grandmaster norm as well before playing today, which is a great result.
I prefer white in this position.
G5.
Yes, g5 and then h4, and in some moment can possible take on e4, king f2, king e3.
Okay.
So, okay.
And the bishop on d4 is very strong.
Yes.
You think bishop d7 is correct?
Okay, maybe not correct, I don't know. But what is choice? F5, maybe. Okay, take castle, rook. F3, rook h3, not bishop b7, but what to
play? Can you go like bishop d7?
Bishop d7, maybe knight b7, and then rook takes e4 is threat, maybe.
You think the main problem of this position is just the bishop on d4 is a very strong piece?
Yes, yeah. It's not so easy, but here, yes. Yes, white is better here, okay. It's question how much better only.
Just simply g5,
yes.
h5, g6.
Yes. Okay, can start also with h4, for example.
Yeah.
I don't know. So, how to play, it's another question.
Yeah, okay, so interesting.
Also, idea even take and king f2 and king e3.
Okay, this is the other idea that
yes, but okay, it's
at some point, maybe you capture here and just bring the king towards the center. And
yes, maybe it's not necessary to do it immediately.
Okay. All right, well, we're just honored to be joined by Chucky here. We just got to have a very short break just to get the streaming just up to scratch here. We'll be back very shortly, so if you just give us a couple of minutes, we'll be back with you. And hopefully Chucky will stay a bit longer. So. Okay, thanks for now anyway. So, yeah.
Okay. Что?
Guys, we have the honor of having Vasily Ivanchuk here in the commentary room with us, and I hope you're as excited as I am to have to hear the thoughts of one of the best players in the world. He's helping us go through a couple of the games we're looking at today. So we are at the game Edouard Romain versus Javaheshvili. Lela Javaheshvili has 6 points out of eight, and she's tied with Zhao Shuai for the lead in the ladies group right now. And in this endgame, Vasily was telling us that an additional idea for white, other than the move g5 and h4 and so on, is this exchange sacrifice. Rook takes e4 with the idea of bringing the king to e3, taking the e4 pawn, and, you know, just having some good compensation for the exchange.
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, so we just did a little summary of that. Let's move on to a new game. Daniil Dubov versus Huang Thanh Trang.
Mm-hmm. So
this is a Dutch defense.
Dutch defense.
That's what Huang Thanh Trang has been playing for many years.
Queen e8. It's Ponomaryov against Gelfand played queen c7 here. Okay, queen e8. It's another possible move. Okay, black wants to play e5, so d5 more or less logical. To bishop d7, rook c1, h6, rook e1, queen f7, knight d4, rook c8. More or less standard position for Leningrad, a variation of Dutch defense. So takes, queen c2. Bishop b2, c4. At least like equal position.
Yeah, it looks okay for black, right?
Yeah, yes, and nothing bad for white too, so.
So what's white going to do with the bishop on g2?
F4. Okay, I don't know if immediately, or maybe even immediately, so f4 is possible. It's possible some waiting move like queen b2, for example, or rook d1. Mm-hmm. This rook d1 also logical. Okay, now rook fd8, more or less possible.
So you think maybe white wants to play like f4 and after trade of bishops to play e4?
Yes, if everything will, if f4 and e4 will be allowed, it can be better for white, but probably black can stop it somehow. For example, rook fd8 now.
Mm-hmm, yeah, we can look at this line, so rook fd8.
And mm-hmm. If f4, maybe black can take and then play d5 and position double edge, because if exchange pawn,
so bishop takes, let's
queen
say
queen takes and d5 now.
So stopping e4.
So it's not so clear, because if take, this pawn,
yeah, the e3
can be
pawn
weak.
Becomes
so
weak.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So okay, unclear position, more or less equal.
Okay, and how about my friend Alex?
Alex.
Yes, how about you give us some
so
insight into this game?
Takes knight c6, a3, bishop a5. What was?
This is an old Korchnoi line, or who played
this? Yes, Karpov played this against Polugayevsky many years ago. Okay. So, queen d3, Polugayevsky played bishop d3, as I remember. So, bishop b6, d takes c5. Of course, if white want to play more complicated game, they could choose rook d1 here.
Right, and so dc5 is actually quite strange, you know? I mean, it makes the position very simple. What can white possibly have here?
Okay.
Bishop b2.
Okay, white is slightly better anyway, so.
What do you think black will play, like bishop d7?
Yes, bishop d7, maybe knight e4 or rook ac1 first. Okay, slightly better for white, nothing special, but it's not draw. It's quite playable position with small edge for white. b6 also possible, yes.
Uh-huh. And how about Ganguly versus Vitugov?
Ganguly-Vitugov.
Some kind of Karakhan.
97, it's all theory. Also quite modern variation. Okay, white choose quite forcing light. Queen d8. So this is for protect knight, because knight e4 now is impossible, because mm-hmm. knight is hanging, so queen d8. Knight e4. Okay, looks like white has better pawn structure, but sometimes can be trouble with h5 pawn. So g3, it's logical to prepare knight h4, but I'm not sure, maybe is it best. Maybe it was played before, also not sure. Knight f6, knight h4, queen d7. So, okay, if f3 now, knight g3 possible, and then rook g1, knight h5, at least not so clear. So queen f3, again attacking pawn, queen d5. So what is this? Aha, so...
There's no knight takes f5 because of knight d2.
Yes, surely. If queen takes f5, queen takes d4. So immediately queen takes d4 was risky because knight takes f5. So queen f3.
Yeah, so, okay, so you're saying that taking this pawn immediately...
Yes, knight
is risky f5. Because of knight f5.
Maybe not risky, maybe just bad.
Right, maybe just bad. Right, yeah. It does look pretty, yes. Pretty bad.
Yes, okay, so queen d5. So and knight takes f5 is impossible.
Right, let's just show our viewers, because some of our viewers are not such strong players, so they need to see these tactics.
Okay. It's
that wins the queen.
So bishop c1.
Yes.
Yes. So now black should play something. So now knight takes...
And you said on queen f5, though, that
queen
now
d4,
queen d4.
Yes, and unpleasant pin.
Right, so the knight
and,
on h4 is not
important
in the right
that
position.
Rook d1 is not protected and not possible to move with bishop. So bishop c1, it looks quite logical, and now black can do some. Black need to do something. Knight f5 is threat, so probably this move more or less expected.
Uh-huh.
If knight f5, knight c3.
Or knight, you mean knight d2?
Ah, even knight d2 is possible,
there, yeah.
Yes. If queen f5 takes and knight c3 and win exchange. So so white should play something.
We're saying that if the queen now takes, that now there's this other discovered attack. Tactic.
Yes.
Knight c3 that wins.
So it's clear that white cannot take on f5. So
right.
So white need to choose something else. Okay. King a1 can be considered. Rook d1 can be considered also.
This kind of looks nice to double
yes.
on the e-file.
Yes. Okay. It's very complicated game.
Do you have any intuitive feeling about this position? Without calculation,
it looks like better for white, but okay, it's such kind of position.
So, you know what's an interesting question is, like, people often ask, what is the role of intuition in chess?
Okay, it depends of level or...
On a strong level, like your level.
Okay, it not only intuition is important, also self-confidence is quite important. Because not always is good to think a lot of time. It's of course you can penetrate to position very deeply, but okay, then you can have time trouble and make blunder even in very good position. So sometimes
how often in important games do you feel like you make a decision based on intuition, because you know you have certain variations you just cannot calculate until the end, and then you just have to move, and then how often does that happen?
Okay, it depends of time control, it depends of opponent, it depends of how important this game, how important is this game, and of course depends of position, because sometimes if you have time and you have feelings that it's possible to find something concrete, there is a lot of reason to calculate. If you have feelings and okay, you have choice between two or three moves more or less similar strange, okay, maybe it's more reasonable to make this choice more quickly. But okay, it's impossible to give advice for each situation.
Right. I have a question. So you about your game with Kramnik in the candidates match, in the candidates tournament in London, mm-hmm. the last game, mm-hmm. and when you realized you were better and you were gonna win, right? And you saw like the effect that this game would have on the tournament standings. I mean, how did that feel? You're kind of holding someone's fate in your hands.
Firstly, I want to tell you that that I was completely sure that if first place will be shared, it will be match against Kramnik and Carlson.
So you didn't know the rules?
I didn't know the rules. Okay, I didn't pretend for first place, so I was not interested so much. Okay, I knew that Kramnik and Carlson before last round has same number of points, so okay, Carlson lost, so I'm better, so I thought that if I win, it will be tie-break
between them.
Something happened, and I myself was very surprised when in press conference me explain it that no tie breaks. It's already strange.
So
it was strange.
So it was kind of nice. You were relieved of that burden of knowing, how important this game was for Kramnik. Do you think you would have felt differently if you would have known how?
I don't know, but if I would know correct situation, it's hardly could help me. So.
Right.
So at least I didn't suffer. Now about I don't know rules exactly.
Right.
Я не страдал от того, что не знал четко правил. Что в тот момент это мне даже помогало, можешь так четче сказать по-английски, то есть.
So how do you, would you say that Anand is not playing so well now because of a lack of self-confidence? Because you mentioned self-confidence is important. Do you think that's a problem for him now?
Okay, I don't know. I didn't speak last time with Anand. Okay, I don't know everything about his life. But okay, some games he plays in very good level. For example, I like very much how he beat Gelfand with black in Slav defense. And also in London, was tournament in London. He played also, I like quality of most of his games. Mm-hmm. London Classic, I mean, in right. December. So I cannot tell that he is in bad form. And
so if you were his coach during the Chennai World Championship match, what would you...
Sorry?
Если ты был бы его тренером во время там Чинайского чемпионата мира, что бы ты ему посоветовал делать по-другому, чем он сделал? So my question is, if Vasily had been his coach during the World Championship,
okay,
match, what would he have advised him?
It's a question because usually for such a match, player has a lot of coaches. So
right.
if you need to specify if I have one if I would be one his second or five seconds more. Advice and something.
No, you're his only coach. You take away everybody else, you're the only person helping him. What would you suggest for him?
From the start?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, but okay, from the start, I could not know what will be result and.
Right. Well, how about you know now?
Now, okay, it's difficult to say. Probably start with immediately,
right.
but I don't know.
Right. Yes, I've heard that said before. Well, that so Vasily, you probably do want to go for your walk now. We've kept you here for a long time. Oh. We really enjoy having you here.
Okay.
But if you want to go, we're of course going to let you go. Thank you very much. It was really very nice of you to join us, and all the best for you tomorrow.
Okay. See you.
Yeah. Thanks so much.
Okay.
Guys, we are back. I don't know if you caught it, but we just had Vasily Ivanchuk here in the commentary room with us for quite a long time. He went over many games with us and answered some questions as to the candidates match, the candidates tournament in London last year, what advice he would give to Anand. We finally got one piece of advice you know, he'd give to Anand if he had been his coach during the World Championship match. Took a little bit of time to get that. And what his thoughts were on the role of intuition in chess. So
it's a great honor to have you come and join us here. So as you mentioned, maybe, you know, a bit tricky to know what questions to ask Ivanchuk.
Right.
And he seemed in quite good spirits.
He did seem quite happy. Yeah.
And yeah.
He has a lot of time for his walk today.
Yeah, exactly. Even though it's raining a bit outside.
But yeah.
Yeah, still an honor to have Ivanchuk join us here. So really, really good.
Yeah, I mean, for me, you know, honestly, like when I gave up my my seat here, I was just so happy just to watch from, you know, somewhere in the room, and I could just watch him analyze games like all day.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it really is a treat to have a player of his level. Like even the small things that he says are just like nuggets of gold, you know?
Of course, and he's the difference between a player like Ivanchuk and maybe players of our standard, I'd say, is that their snap judgment of positions. I mean, we get a rough idea, but they can really just see through all the rubbish and sort of define a position extremely quickly. Yeah. And Ivanchuk is, you know, quite potentially one of the most, if not the most talented chess player maybe ever. You know, he's got a great feeling for chess, and you know, sometimes his nerves or something has let him down in the past, but still absolute, he's sort of one of the, genius, I think, is an overused word. And Carlsen is sort of genius level in some respects, but Ivanchuk might be one of the only other chess players who I'd say is pretty much genius level. Some of his calculations and things are just unbelievable.
So real honor to have Chucky join us.
You know, the other interesting thing though, Simon, I noticed that is that he did refrain from making snap judgments. He was trying not to, right? It was always like everything was based on some calculation. He wasn't saying anything immediately.
Yeah.
You know, nothing was completely clear cut, okay? You know, this one is equal, okay, this one's a bit better, but you know, it's not the end of the game, you know. And that was actually his approach to every single question I asked him. Yeah. Did you notice that? He never answered any question from the beginning straight away, except a factual one, which was when he revealed that when he was playing Kramnik, and I was trying to, you know, I was interested to know how he felt knowing that he held someone's fate in his hands. Mm. You know, someone who, you know, from they're from the same generation, played with each other for so many years, and especially if you have, you know, good relations with a person, and you know that for you it doesn't matter at all. For this person, half a point means a totally different life. You know, like a chance to play the world championship match again, a chance maybe to be world champion. So I just wonder how he felt about that during the game, and then we found out that he did not have any of those feelings because he had no idea the importance of this game. He didn't know that in the case of a tie between Carlsen and Kramnik, that Carlsen would be moving forward based on his greater number of wins. That was the tie break in place in London. In fact, he thought that in the case of a tie, Kramnik and Carlsen would be playing a playoff. A tiebreak match, so he didn't feel any pressure at all, and that was something new. That was new for us, and I think probably for a lot of people.
Did you have a chance to ask him whether he knew whether he's playing with a clock or not? I mean, I don't know. That's quite a hard one to say, really.
Well, that's very funny, brave, Simon. You know, yeah, you got to be brave. I didn't want to, I didn't want to chase him out of the room. I actually enjoyed having him here.
Of course,
you know,
of course. But it would have been very fascinating.
So basically, besides like that factual question, every single question he answered, you know, he qualified with it depends on this, no black and white. So that was interesting.
Yeah. Okay. So very interesting.
But you know, it's usually that way. You know, the people who are very, the higher up you go in something, the more you allow for doubts, even though you're supposed to be an expert in it.
Yeah. He's a very interesting character. Anyway, kind of unique.
Yeah. No, it's very cool to have him here. And he's a, you know, of course you can tell the only reason he's here is because he loves chess.
Sure.
I'm sure it's not, you know, just he has nothing better to do but than hang out here. But that he likes to analyze, you know, and he's happy to give his opinion. So
kind of reminds me of Spock out of Star Trek. Is that fair to say?
I don't know. I don't ever watch Star Trek.
Bit of a genius. But anyway, apparently we're going to go back to the games now. Just worth mentioning that he brought two chess clocks right after the game. With Kamsky, so maybe that's going to help his time. Maybe he's going to watch them for a while and realise how they tick. No, they're actually for his chess school back home, so it's great to see supporting chess, you know, in his home country as well. Another game I'm very interested in here is Erik Hansen's game with the white pieces against Lee Chow. Now, Eric's having a great tournament so far. He's a young Canadian player and on a great score and a great position, has some great results. But Lee Chow is a very strong Chinese player. And if we just look at the game here, we'll just go through the opening moves quite quickly. We have a standard Sicilian opening, but a bishop b5 Sicilian. And this has all been seen many times before. c3. And it kind of looks like in a position very soon, around this point, I had a look at the clock times. And basically, Black was doing very well on the clock, and Eric, I believe, had spent something like 30 minutes, maybe more than 30 minutes, maybe 40 minutes. So it kind of looks like he was out of theory in this position, which is never a good sign, especially with the white pieces. So he obviously wasn't expecting this opening to occur at the board. And, white has more space advantage, kind of typical position, but sometimes white's central pawns can become extremely... extremely weak. So the pawn on e5 could be weak, especially with g4 coming in, pressurizing the center. And in general, this it can be overextended, white center here, so white has to be very careful. Hence why white plays h3, and this move stops bishop g4. I actually saw another game in a similar position where black played some idea here with bishop f5 to try to put this bishop on e4, which was quite interesting. Because trying to just get rid of the knight on f3. Knight on f3 is a very good defender. But okay, taking on e5, very natural. Knight takes, and now knight to f5. And just a snap judgment, as judgments, I won't do a Ivanchuk and spend too much time on this position.
and I'll probably get my judgment completely wrong here, but it looks like Black's got everything he'd like to get out of the opening. Two bishops, open lines, maybe a weak pawn on d4. Okay, White's got this outpost on e5, so this could be, you know, something that Black could be concerned about, but only one piece developed, really, the knight on e5. So b3, very slow way to play. And now, well, a knight takes c6 is a move, yeah, obviously a critical option here. And what was the idea here? Well, queen b6 is one very interesting idea. Let's just have a look at this. So queen b6, it's a bit like a French defense where Black just pressurizes the d4 pawn. For example, now if White now grabs another pawn, knight takes e7, you probably capture this pawn, and now continue with bishop takes d4. And f2 is probably going to be dropping. I say probably because you have bishop e3 here. Maybe bishop e3. Two bishops in an open position such as this can be very, very, very dangerous. So I don't know. Can you go bishop e3? I want to get rid of this bishop if I can.
Bishop e3 is a good move.
Because d5 may be dropping as well. Yeah. Then you're actually in danger of getting checkmated if you take e3. So what was the idea after knight takes c6? Queen b6 looks so obvious.
Yeah, it is obvious. It's not maybe the only move though.
Yeah. Queen b6, and now I don't know what else can we try. Queen d6.
Yeah, maybe? Queen d6. You can try. The queen d6. You go to e5. Yes, because on knight d4, you know, you just have queen d4 and you protect everything.
Yeah. So this doesn't seem to work exactly. Queen b6 looks logical. And then let's just have a look at slide. Knight takes e7. Knight takes rook takes e7. What was Black's idea here? Take it on d4, or is there something else? Is there some queen f6 move, maybe?
I mean, there's a rook f2. Oh, no, there's no rook f2, because the rook takes g7.
Can you go here, Irina? Queen f6.
Mm-hmm. Rook e2.
Rook e2, and now bishop a6, something like this, mm-hmm. Trying to use these bishops.
Yep. Rook c2.
Rook c2.
I mean, bizarre. Look at the development that White has. It's pretty funny.
Very strange. But White, there's two pawns up here.
White wants to play bishop e3.
Yeah, and if White can go bishop e3, knight c3, he's obviously fully developed. Yeah. So I don't think this is the exact reason why White didn't take on c6. So there must be a reason here why knight c6 wasn't played. I mean, okay, let's have a look at queen b6, this position again. This position after rook takes e7 looks very critical. So, rook takes e7, and we need a good move for Black now. We need a good move here, so, yeah. So, I can't see anything, like, immediate. See immediate refutation of this idea.
Yeah, bishop d4, I mean.
Bishop d4, bishop e3.
Well. And, can we try what about queen d4? Is that like so awful? Is queen d4 just so bad if we trade queens?
Well, you have to be a bit, you don't have to be careful of rook g7, do you?
No, I don't.
Really?
Oh, maybe I do.
I don't know. This might be tactically bad for White because you haven't got many pieces developed, so it looks scary. As
well, at least I can...
A draw, at least, yeah.
At least I can make a draw, yeah. Yeah. I assume. I mean, I can always make a draw, but
yeah,
I can go and win this also. Yeah,
definitely. This is not the reason.
So this is not. So I'm trying to just see if maybe the queen was a useful defender for White, and of now you have f2 hanging. You don't have bishop e3. Well, my main point was so there wouldn't be bishop e3 in this position. Yeah, you go rook e2, right, Simon? It's like the only move. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I guess so. Rook e2, and now.
Now, if my bishop, yes, look at this, Simon. Maybe now so I can go here.
So I have to go rook d2.
Right, because if you go rook c2, at the very, very least, I have this move, which wins me back. Which wins me back a pawn.
You do this.
Course, Black is doing very well here.
But you can do this against rook d2 because I'm check on c1 as well.
Okay,
maybe,
so on.
Maybe this could be the reason.
Here,
yeah.
Right. Good point, Simon. That. Doesn't really matter if you do that. I can still do the same thing because when you go here, I go rook f1 here. And Black is doing very well because of that pin on the first rank. I mean, it doesn't really matter that he, you know, he's down a pawn because his position is certainly going to be, you know, on the verge of winning here after his rook comes down to e1 and he takes that knight on b1.
Yeah.
You know, actually, I have an interesting question for our viewers, Simon.
Yeah.
And we would like to know, you know, who you guys are, you know, and sort of what level you're at so we can sort of tailor our comments and our commentary to that. Don't you think that would be useful for us to know, Simon?
Yeah, I imagine we've got a wide range of different levels out there.
You can sort of you can sort of tweet us what you think. You know, is our commentary appropriate for you? Are you guys following the variations and the explanations, or is it a little bit too advanced or maybe too simple? If you're a 2600 GM, you will tell us our commentary is a little bit too simple. But and I think, you know what, for the future, I think, Simon, there should actually be a questionnaire on the tournament website for people who watch commentary. Don't you think? Why do we have no link to our audience?
Yeah, it was useful.
So that, I think that's something we can improve for next year.
Mm. Yeah, definitely. And I mean, let's just, okay, should we go to the current position in this game just to get up to date with what's happening on top board? So this is where we stand in Eric's game with white against Li Chao.
So let's just see what happened. B3, C5. I didn't really like that move, B3, just instinctively. I didn't, but D4, queen, D3. So black sacked a pawn. Black sacks a pawn to get to this position. Okay. So obviously, all would be good for white if there wasn't this move d3, and there's bishop b2.
This has been a total success of black this opening.
You think
sure.
so? Really? Why? Yeah. Why are you so sure?
Do I have to go d3? Has this b3 been played? Oh, it has been played.
Bishop it has b2. Been played. No, d3, okay. bishop b2 so has
guess,
been played.
I guess knight d4 is one move. After d3 has been played, knight d4.
Knight d4.
I mean, I don't know, knight d4 looks very, very sensible here. So if I just plonk this knight on the square and maybe threaten knight c2.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe, I don't know.
Knight
a3. Knight a3.
For example, I mean, of course, I don't want to put my knight there, but.
And now, actually, I also had d2. Let's just have a think. So, sorry, I was just trying
d2,
to work out.
D2, I played d2. Knight 1. Knight b takes d2.
So I can't play it here. So, yeah, tactically, I got some weird moves here. I don't know. Like, tactically, black's pieces are very well placed.
Oh, okay.
But it just depends whether this pawn on d3 is really a strength or a weakness.
D2 now, though.
Sorry, knight e2 now looks.
No,
yeah.
D2.
D2 now. D2 now, and if knight takes.
Oh,
you take on b2. Yeah, so d2 here. Is a good move. Maybe I guess you can just move your rook though. Does this d2 move help? I mean, also what about knight e2 check here?
Mm-hmm. King f1.
Well, king
f1. There's knight g3. Yeah.
I don't know if knight g3 helps too much, does it? So I don't know. Strength.
I'm not sure. Is white playing for a win here, Simon? I mean, what? I'm sorry. Is black playing for a win? I'm not sure.
I think
mean,
black's playing
you
for
think
win.
So? I'm not sure about that because I mean, like just looking at this, it's very concrete, right? So you're either going to be down a pawn.
Yeah, it just depends on this d-pawn. Is it
right
for a weakness? And
I mean, because okay, after bishop b2, we just want to play knight d2 and just be winning, right? So white's very close to consolidating. White's not really, you know, if you look at this position, well, white hasn't completed his development, but neither has black. So there's nothing going on where you would think there's like black has this preponderance of forces. So I kind of feel like a draw would not even be a bad result for black.
Yeah, I don't know. It looks on the surface very scary for white. I mean, maybe. White's on this game. Knight d4.
I agree.
Must be
knight
critical.
D4 looks.
And now knight to now knight to a3.
Yeah, and I think there's a decent chance that the game could
I
go this way.
No chance.
No chance.
No chance.
King f1.
I just don't believe black on this score group outrates his opponent.
Make some
score.
Moves, Simon, before
I'm not
play. Before I play, you know, here and win all of your pawns.
Yeah, I'm not getting 92 check. I mean, I've got time here. I don't need to rush, maybe.
You don't really have any time because I'm about to play rook d1.
Well, that gives me at least two moves, which is some time. I mean, I could go bishop f5. I'm scared, but
Okay, I mean, I don't know. We'll come back to this. Okay, let's have a bet. This seems
let's have a bet.
Disagree, so let's
disagree.
Go for it.
We're not really even sure. You know, Simon likes black. I think,
like black.
You know, white. Okay, I'll take. I say white. Well, I say this course of the game shows that white is not in trouble. That's all. I'm not saying white's winning, but I'm saying the course of the game will show that white's not in trouble.
I'd say black's better. Just better.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll see. We come back in half an hour and we'll see.
Sounds good.
Okay. I might be apologizing yet again for my lack of understanding, but as I did yesterday in reports game. Okay, well, let's just have a look at some tweets. So thank you for the kind comments which have been coming in. It's always nice to hear the kind comments, and sometimes the unkind comments are also quite entertaining. We have got really reasonably thick skin, haven't we?
Yeah.
I think so, yeah, of course. Yeah, so we can cope with it.
So it looks like, at least from what what we see over here in the tweets, our viewers are pretty pretty advanced players, Simon.
Yeah, definitely, quite. So we keep the level as it is at the moment anyway. Well, it's a bit late now, it's round nine. So you're sort of tough luck if you haven't enjoyed it so far. You've been tuning into the wrong channel. So, and some, okay, the other games that are going on, maybe some games we haven't looked at here. Lots of entertaining games. So, well, an interesting game here is Hare Krishna's game. So let's just...
Versus Zhao Shui.
Zhao Shui.
Yeah.
So, okay, let's just have a look at this, because I think there's been some...
It's very important. Very important for the women's standings. It's higher
important.
Up. Yep.
So, okay, let me just... Hare Krishna is black. And, okay, well, again... This opening that Paco used earlier on, b6, is the move that Hare Krishna tried here. And this is not main line, should we say. It's not a main line opening. But, and now white picked a very...
Paco used that against who? Was it against
Ganguly.
Surya? Against Ganguly, right?
Yeah.
And he got a decent game.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, got a very good game. But f3 just looks like a critical move here.
Okay.
This must be critical. Try to build up an even bigger center. But very quickly, we get a very dynamic position.
So this kind of just a...
Big center.
Grunfeld on the wrong side.
Yeah, it's a very strange Grunfeld. I mean, you could go g6 here and say, okay, we now play double Grunfeld, kind of weird fianchetto system.
Yep.
I don't know. Okay, but e5 kind of looks natural to try to do something in the middle of the board. And, okay, white takes his pawn on e5.
Mm-hmm.
And now white defends his pawn. We kick quick. And queen a4, I like this move. It's a little sort of a semi-aggressive move. Stops black capturing on e5. And maybe this bishop comes to b5 or a6.
Makes it difficult also for black to castle queenside because the a7 pawn would hang.
Because a7, indeed. And c6, very passive move to play.
I have to admit, I didn't understand everything that happened here. Mm-hmm. Like, so e5, d, e. First, I guess the number one question, well, okay, so often there's, you know, queen trade would be, you know, black's idea here, at least makes white's king a bit awkward, and then playing knight d7.
I guess white's saying, well, I'll just go bishop f4.
Yeah, bishop f4, yeah. And I guess there's just not, is there not enough compensation? Because there's, how about g6? How about g6? I mean, because, you know, I'm just thinking these pieces are a little bit, you know, maybe you can afford to do this. And I mean, my point also is that if you ever try to give up the pawn this way.
If I go.
I'm going to go back there in a second.
I think if I go bishop b5 here, and if c6, I just drop back to c4, then then you go bishop g7. Sorry, yeah, so it's probably okay as well. You don't really want to play c6, but it's not so bad, is it? I wanted to go e6, but c3 drops at some point, but I don't think this is particularly.
Yeah, I almost Simon could even just like make this move for now.
Try to put your king in e6.
Yeah, I mean almost. I could almost do that if you did something like that. I could like. You know, even like do something like this and try to get my pawn back.
This is looking fine, but
so I don't know. I just, you know, as a queen's gambit accepted player, we often see this type of move e5 by black. You know, it's often that there's an exchange of queens, and then in this endgame, you try to use the fact that white's obviously not very developed here, and their king is also going to have to spend a couple of moves, you know, getting into castle normal position. You know, you have to play king c2, rook d1, so.
I mean, it's quite an interesting game, this, because there's a lot of pressure on white, because, you know, if white wins this game, white's a great position in the ladies section. And, you know, because this could guarantee sort of £10,000 a win for white this game already. I mean, I know there's a lot of pressure on the last round for the men's, but the ladies section is starting to get a gap in the field. So this is a really big game for white. And I have to say, I like the way the game's developed for white.
Yeah.
I think white's position is looking very promising. So, but of course, Hare Krishna is a class act, and it's not going to.
Yeah, there are many things I don't really, many questions that I would have about this game, Simon. Even here, maybe g6, but okay, queen e7, I sort of understand. Queen a4, I understand.
Good move. Very good move, yeah.
Yeah.
And now white's pieces are coming into the game very quickly here.
So let's see. So black, sort of moving away from the idea of winning the e5 pawn, but then he wants to fianchetto his bishop.
This is a nice move. I really like this e6 move. Look at this bishop on d6. The strange thing about this current
position. This looks much better for white.
Yeah, I mean, basically, often to get this position, it's very like this opening. Just trying to memorize this position, and we saw this in the World Championship match recently between Magnus and Anand, and there's a very, I'll just show you the position where white sacrifices a pawn for a very similar position. So this is the triangle variation, which I think Anand chose against Carlsen, and Carlsen did not sacrifice his pawn here. Oh, sorry, my mistake.
Oh, he played knight c3,
but this position mm-hmm. here you see very often. It's a line I've played a number of times. And if you compare this position here where whites are pawned down, but with very active play,
right,
to the position they've got in the game, it's got similarities, but white's not a pawn down here.
No.
And the bishop on d6 is just...
No, I like white's position. I feel like black has done something wrong to get to this, because white has an edge for free, just like absolutely for free. Black obviously has a problem castling. He's probably going to be, but he doesn't only have a problem with the king. That's the funny thing. Mm. It's not just like the bishop being on d6, that's good. Okay, there's the bishop on b7, that's a problem.
Yeah.
There's the 4-on-3 majority in the center, right? I mean, the 4-on-3 majority is like a very important factor here. It means that like pretty much any end game is also going to be better for white.
Sure. It looks very unpleasant for black. I mean, if I got this position, do you castle queenside here? Can you play this? I mean, I want to go queen a4.
Queen a4 and come back.
I just want to checkmate. Queen a4. And then I have ideas. Just queen a7.
Maybe there's some discovered attack on that bishop, or can't we do anything?
Some knight jump.
Some knight jump.
Where does the knight jump to?
Yeah, not to f4.
And of course, just take it on a7. So we can see on the webcam, actually. These two guys in a minute that they're playing, we can see their sort of body language. Hopefully you can get a view in them. So you've got Hare Krishna there. Doesn't really give much away on this picture we see.
No, he's already given away a lot in his position. That's
he's
enough.
He's given away too much in his position. That's right. Well, the other thing is, Irene, I mean, if you ever do attack this bishop, at the worst, I can always play e5.
Yeah,
but, I know that knight g5 is a ridiculous move, but just to prove a point, e5 does...
Yeah.
Still consolidate my bishop on d6, so queen a4 is looking...
Maybe it's too dangerous to castle, unless you're ready to play a5 here, Simon.
Yeah.
Play a5?
Oh,
can
ready.
I show you a nice line?
Oh, bishop a6. Sorry,
yes.
Sorry.
Yes, exactly, Simon, exactly. Yeah. I mean, just
where's
a...
castle?
Just
castle?
A move. He has castled, okay.
Wow.
Well, I mean, so this is a move that exists. Our viewers should just know about it. Threatening... a nice little checkmate in one move. Well, almost in one move, because there's knight c7 blocking, but it doesn't really help. Queen takes c6 next. Well,
checkmate.
It's actually not that easy to protect the c-pawn.
Maybe you have to go knight d4 here, but I mean, e5 and something, you probably just lose a piece, actually.
No, this just looks like bad position, and I think maybe some critical things were happening around here. Maybe black should have traded queens and tried to play differently.
Right. Certainly an opening success for white. And the question is, after queen a4, which black has castled queenside, so if white... Okay, well, white played very quickly instead of queen a4, which looks much more critical. White very quickly castled kingside, and this is not necessarily a bad move, because of course you still have long-term potential. But I mean, if I was playing this position with white, I'd really want to punish my opponent for playing some rather slack opening moves, and I don't like to play this queen a4 move.
Yeah.
Queen a4 is just kind of move where you just try to punish your opponent for playing in rather a strange manner.
In fact, you still have the threat of bishop a6 here, not only queen takes a7.
Yeah. I don't know, is there some tactic here? So, yeah, B5, I was thinking here, maybe I just take on A7.
Rook d6, maybe.
Rook d6, and are you surviving here? Rook takes d6, pawn takes
c4. I think black is... maybe. I mean, castles are still very dangerous.
Go rook b1. But this is... And a nice point is, if you go queen e7 at some point, I mean, for example, a line here could be something like rook d8, and now maybe I go rook b1. I don't know if this works, but I'm just pointing out, if queen e7 we go, rook takes c6 is just a nasty tactical point. I mean, castles is a good move as well, yeah.
Castles is fine.
Because now we're just trying to play a similar kind of thing, but we've got another piece in the game. So
yeah.
I think white's doing very well. And again, this could be a critical game for the ladies' standings, because if white can win, white's probably guaranteed something like £10,000, which is not a bad paycheck, is it? So not a bad paycheck at all. You only get that kind of money in poker normally. So I only said that because we have Stuart Rubin sitting in the front row. So, yeah, it's very rare to get 10,000 open. So
you know, it's interesting. Yeah. It's actually pretty advantageous for a woman to be in this this particular point group here, at 6 points, because first of all, you already have a lot of points. Second of all, a draw for you is not a bad result,
mm-hmm.
right? You're still going to be doing well in the ladies section, but the people you're going to be playing against will desperately want to beat you. And they're going to take a lot of risks. So someone like Hare Krishna, I mean, he plays this rather non-classical opening, right? And, you know, already it's pretty early in the game and he's gotten himself in trouble.
Yeah.
So it's because, you know, for him, winning is absolutely critical.
Yeah.
He has 6 points and, if he wants to really fight for first place, he needs to win. But for white in this game, you know, she could just play kind of normally, of course, take advantage of her opponent's mistakes. A draw would have been pretty good for her as well.
Yeah, of course. And as we saw, I believe a couple of years ago, can't remember actually which year it was now, but Ho Yifan.
This was in 2012.
Well. 2012, so it was 2 years ago. And
obviously,
Ho Yifan won the ladies' prize. She also won a lot of money in the males competition in the open. Well, first equal, yeah, was it?
First equal.
Yeah, with Nigel won the prize.
With Nigel, mm-hmm.
And then she even won sort of junior prize, so it's a serious paycheck. I don't know if she won the junior prize as well, but you can win a lot of money anyway. Loads of money. It's on offer here.
The only one she couldn't have was the seniors' prize as well.
Senior's prize as well. Yeah, another one offer. I don't think Ho Yifan would be able to win that quite yet, but maybe in the future. Well, okay, there's a couple more moves. I mean, let's just see. Let's just see what's happened. So, castles, knight d4. Okay. So, some tactical solution to this, but this does drop a pawn.
Is this what happened?
This is what happened.
Oh,
yeah.
Knight d4 happened.
Maybe this is what was the plan was after queen a4.
So c takes d4, queen d6, bishop f7 is what you're talking about, Simon?
This is the current position. And white has picked up a very useful pawn.
This is the current position?
This is the current position.
So black just admitted that he's like lost.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. Yeah, I totally agree.
Man.
Black's just saying, I'm completely lost.
I'm completely lost. Might as well give you a pawn to not get checkmated. Look how...
Yeah, king b8.
Yeah, there's nothing. Yeah, I mean, okay. Yeah.
I'm just going to play a pawn down and...
pawn down,
lost. So it's really,
you know, maybe he'll, maybe try to play c5 and get the dark squares or something.
Yeah, I mean, even then, d5 is just, I mean,
we have some important questions in our tweets, Simon. That, for example, we can bring this one up. First of all, we were told that the three of us are doing a great job today.
Good job. Thank you
for all these great moves you're telling us.
So there's a happy monkey at the moment, okay?
Yeah, and another person says, can the monkey be a permanent part of the commentary team? Well, I think here in Gibraltar, he's always going to be welcome.
Yeah, can take my place quite easily, I think, so maybe next year.
So, in fact, when you go for your next break, Simon, I think I'll just put him in your place.
Yeah, no, you won't notice the difference. People wouldn't, so.
All right, well, things are looking good for Zhao Xue, and she has a good chance of actually consecutively winning the ladies' prize in this tournament, because she is last year's winner.
Cool.
Last year she drew Ivanchuk in the last round with the white pieces.
Yeah, very impressive.
So I like her position, unless her technique lets her down. And the truth is, anything can still happen, because as we saw from the game yesterday, Libezuski versus Salgado, where Fabian just won a pawn out of the opening, had a crushing position, and then he absolutely destroyed it.
Yeah.
And wound up losing. So anything can still happen, I guess, especially when you're playing against the bishop pair. But, you know, there's no doubt that white has a very big advantage here.
How about we now look at Murray Chook's game, just to see how
This is on board against Sandy Pan, and just to see how the other lady's playing. So just try to bring this up.
Which one is that?
This is Sandy Pan versus Muzychuk.
Muzychuk.
And obviously, if Black can win this game, then she keeps in contention with the ladies' prize. And this is the current position. And Ivanchuk was saying he quite preferred White's position a bit earlier on.
And he would still prefer White's position.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, this
it's only getting better for White.
Yeah. What's Black got this position? Black really hasn't got much compensation for
having given up the light squares. C4 square belongs to White. You know, White's going to play B3, knight's B2, knight C4. The bishop on E7 is misplaced. It's on the wrong diagonal. There's no pressure.
And also, right? White's just got the long-term possibility at some point playing E5.
Can I make a guess as to the next move, Simon? Can I?
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's just discuss the candidate moves. I mean, there's rook E1. Right, that's a good one.
Yeah.
Well, there's H3, which is probably not really necessary, but you know, you see that move in the Benoni to keep your bishop on that diagonal. It's not really a bad move. Actually, I wouldn't be that surprised if we saw H3. And there's B3. I think these are my top three moves for White.
Yeah.
E5 is probably too early.
I just mentioned someone's actually said that there's a striking resemblance between Simon and the monkey, which I strongly think that's true. So let me just see if I can do the same pose and if you can see who's the monkey and who's Simon. I don't know. Okay, sorry. Just had to see how similar we are. Similar kind of hair color, maybe?
Similar hair color. It's the auburn hair, you know?
Auburn, yeah. Okay, so yeah, White's doing very well here, definitely. And Black's got a problem. This d6 pawn is also a chronic weakness on this square. This is horrible position.
Do you want to make
as long as you let me bet on White in any possibility.
I want to bet on the move White will make, because that's harder, obviously. We know White's better.
Sure. I mean, rook to e1 looks logical. Rook to e1 just looks like a logical move. I mean, b3 is logical. Let me just think about this for a second. Tactically speaking, e5 is tactically sort of screaming at me as well.
E5, there's knight d5.
Bishop
haunted.
E4.
Oh.
I don't know, I mean, e5 is a way to try to kill Black immediately, which you don't. It's only good if it works, obviously, but, maybe.
Pawn takes e5?
Pawn takes e5, and then can I just play bishop?
Yeah, my guess would be that intuitively that you're just not prepared for that move.
No,
and that given that Black is doing so badly positionally, there's no reason to help them at all.
Nearly works e5. It's just a move Black always has to watch out for. I'll go for rook e1.
I'll go for h3.
H3, okay. H3 is a good way to drop the bishop back to h2 as well. Okay.
And what happens if he plays b3? No one wins?
B3 again is looks like a good move.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, well, I think any of these moves are actually pretty good, and they all fit into White's plans, but you know, we have to make some bets along the way. So
it's just too many good moves for White. This is a problem in this position. Yeah, it's actually quite, sometimes it's quite tricky when you've got so many good moves, because you know, you sort of panic and you have to play one of them.
But let's take a look at some interesting things have happened in the game. Duba versus Huang Thang Trang.
Okay. And actually, I saw Dubov earlier, just in the bar area. This is probably about 10:30 in the morning. And, he's a young Russian Russian player. And I actually was asking him how he prepares in the morning. And he claimed not really to use a computer. He said, I just have a quick look for 10 minutes, and then I just play.
Yeah, that's good.
I don't know. I mean, maybe this is true, but he's a very, very likable kid and a very strong player. So
look how interesting this is. Now, this is a game that we've seen with Ivanchuk. While Ivanchuk was here, I'll show you the point. Yeah, around this point, Simon, right here. This is when we last saw it. Rook cd1, rook. Okay, we were wondering which rook would go there. We thought rook fd8. We actually thought rook fd8 made more sense. So the way we talked about this position with Ivanchuk is not what we actually see over here so much. We thought something like rook fd8 would be played. And Ivanchuk shows a very instructive line. Let's say White plays f4. And because I asked him, I actually asked him what his plans are, you know, for this bishop. So obviously does not look like such an impressive piece. And he said to play f4 is an idea. Bishop takes g2, queen g2. Now if white can get in the move e4,
yeah.
White is actually going to be better, I think, because his pawn structure is more solid than black's, and his king is going to be kind of safer. And in a heavy piece endgame, which is what we're going to get, because there's going to be a trade of knights, you know, white chance would be better. So Ivanchuk suggested this move for black, d5, and said that this position was balanced. You know, because in the event of a trade on d5, it's clear that, you know, this pawn on e3 is also weak. So, I don't know, where does the rook belong? Maybe does it belong on the c file, or maybe one rook should be on d file and the other rook on the e file? So, Huang Thing played rook cd8, and white did not hurry with f4. Black still played d5.
I wish I stuck to my intentions with the Sandy Pan game. I'm really regretting changing my move. I only regretted changing my move after you convinced me not to say it, Irina.
Oh, really, Simon?
He played e5.
He played e5.
So, yeah, so.
Oh, well. We'll take a look at that. We'll take a look at that. CD, ED, B4. Okay, this is kind of typical stuff, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is a very similar way to play against these hanging pawns, isn't it? Once you capture on d5. The pawns on d5 and c5, you have to, if you're white, obviously you're trying to prove that they're hanging pawns and they're weak. If you're black, you're trying to prove that the pawns on c5 and d5 are actually strong and quite mobile. So the battle often is whether these pawns are strong or weak, and b4 is a very good way just to try to take control of the square you highlighted there, d4. So
this b4 move is extremely common positionally in these types of positions to try to get control over the d4 square. So you're trying to, you know, turn that d5 pawn into a weakness on its own and highlight the fact that the light squared bishop is not very good. So, but you know, on the other hand, the structure of course is not perfect for white because the pawn is committed to f3. If it was on f2, it'd be a different story. Right, Simon?
Yeah.
But you also have a weakness on e3.
Yeah, I like white's position here anyway, I think. I mean,
this is a positional pawn sack. We've seen, there's a game, I feel like Petrosian played a game like this. Sack of the queenside pawn in order to basically, you get everything you want in this position, right? Your knight to d4, and then he's probably going to switch his attention to either the c or the a file with his rooks. Right, what do you think, Simon? I mean, black's king is potentially quite weak, and the knight getting to d4 is very unpleasant because of the e6 square.
Yeah, I mean,
so I like white.
It's another problem with the Dutch defense in general, which I mentioned in a previous game. I think Richard Report's game where he played the Dutch, and he had a nice victory there. But the problem having this pawn on f5 is you can't put it back on f7, and you play this move on move one, and yeah, this can be a major problem with the Dutch because often it's a very aggressive move, f5, just the fact that black's played it, but it does make a lot of weaknesses, and here you can just see e6 is now a serious weakness because the pawn's not on f7, and even the long diagonal, you look at b2 to g7 towards the black king, again you can never block this diagonal with a move f6, so this pawn on f5 is, if the pawn was back on f7, I'd say black's absolutely fine, but I think now white is happy, even though white's pawn down here. Very good compensation for the pawn. You know, good piece is pressure. But I mean, it's a long way off trying to prove this compensation. Your knight goes to d4, and you know, you still have to, you know, there's still a lot of work.
Maybe black is going to be putting his rooks on the e file.
Yeah, try to put
maybe,
the rooks on the e file.
Maybe rook e7.
Yeah, black maybe not, you know.
Even here.
Would probably say that black's okay here.
I would think so.
But even though,
you know, maybe that bishop should even be transferred to f7. So how about this move, Simon? I kind of like this move for
white to play here.
Oh, okay. It's white to play. So knight d4. Do you have time for rook e7? Or do you think the knight should go to f4?
Yeah.
So I quite like d4 for the knights.
You like d4.
Again, I'm still trying to work out a way here that white can increase the pressure. And, you know, white's pieces look very nice, but all the pieces on d-file look kind of silly now as well. So, you know, I think maybe it's just a balanced position, because it is a pawn as well, you know, it's a whole pawn, which is quite useful for black. So maybe we'll come back to this game and see how it develops. I mean, white's obviously got compensation, but I don't know whether it's, you know, we'll see whether it's enough. I mean, if we look at Dreyev's game against Salim from UAE, this is exciting Benoni. And we'll just bring up this position. So Dreyev against Salim. And yeah, it must be mentioned actually that the sad news about Gashimov, you know, passing away. And Gashimov was a complete legend with the Benoni. He made the Benoni popular again. He was a great chess player and unfortunately died at a very young age, which was very sad. But his playing the Benoni really popularized it at top level and at club level as well. And, you know, he was a phenomenal player, and sad to see him pass away at such an unfortunate age. But, the position quickly resembles the Benoni. And now, whenever I think of Benoni, you just have to think of Gashmore's great games he played in it, especially now. And we see that, okay, we get a trance, you know. This is a typical Benoni position, isn't it, really?
Except the pawn is not an e4. Yeah. It would be typical with the pawn on e4, it is different with the pawn back on e3.
This is kind of the modern way of playing the Benoni as white. I mean, white often now plays, and I think Kramnik first made this reasonably popular, of actually playing with a pawn on e3 instead of a pawn on e4.
You don't have to worry about defending that pawn, you can transfer your knight to c4 right away. Yeah.
And also it does, you know, it does a good job, the pawn on e3, of defending the d4 square for tactical reasons, and you still have this, I mean, The trendy line nowadays is this position, but with bishop on c1 on f4, which puts pressure on d6. So this pawn on e3 is just a kind of modern treatment of the bone.
Yeah, I mean, it's just an interesting move order that he went through, Dreyev. Yeah. I mean, obviously now trying to get an opening edge, g6, but just trying to play the game, c4, bishop g7, and just e3.
Yeah, it's interesting. e3 is a move which I've never faced myself before. And maybe this is, you know...
I've actually played a game in this line recently. Okay.
Oh, interesting.
I've played this.
I mean, maybe Dreyev probably knows that Salim is being coached by Ivan Sokolov, and Ivan's just here as just Salim's only coach. So maybe Dreyev's thinking, right, well, you know, my opponent's obviously going to be very well prepared. I don't really fancy playing a game against Sokolov today. You know, I'd rather just play a normal game. So I'm just going to go e3 or move 4 and just play some chess. So it's maybe quite an interesting... you know, way to avoid preparation, just play chess. Yeah.
So he actually gave up a tempo, and he still decided to play e4.
Okay, so he's gone e4 anyway. Which is, standard position. Well, knight h5 is a Bobby Fischer idea, isn't it?
Yeah.
Maybe it should be mentioned that I think Bobby Fischer was one of the first players in this position. I mean, Tao was a great exponent of the Benoni as well. Bobby Fischer played it maybe once or twice in his life, maybe possibly more, but he was more famous for King's Indian defense. And I think Bobby was the first player to sort of play knight to h5 in a position similar to this, which looks absolutely kind of suicidal, and it can be suicidal. Yeah, I mean, you have to judge this move so carefully, because I mean, you're destroying your pawn structure. After this, you're weakening, most importantly, the f5 square. This square on f5 is just a major weakness now. But you're hoping to gain dynamic compensation in response to this, you know, with an open g-file. I haven't really seen this plan being played with the queen on c7, because normally you want to follow up with, you know, the queen coming over here. The queen is very passive on c7 here. It just does not look like a good square for the queen. So very double-edged position. And we can see the body language there. We'll come to the current position soon. And I don't know, I mean, maybe we can try to see if there's any players placing about as well, Irene, if one of us wants to have a look. I don't know if you're happy doing that.
I'll go see how the games are going, Simon.
Sure.
And I will come back to you with maybe a cappuccino if you want.
That sounds good, yeah.
Okay, I'll see you in a few minutes.
Right. We'll just continue with this position where Irina has a break. So knight's ball, west ball, west ball, west ball, west ball.